So this is all about me. I contribute to Mozilla as a add-ons contributor, add-ons content reviewer, Firefox add-ons mentor, and all these things are mentioned here. So these all other things are related to add-ons. Apart from that, I do lots of stuff in Mozilla itself. So today I'll be talking about these things: browser add-ons, web extensions, architecture of web extensions, few of the web extensions API, and also how can you port your Chrome extensions to Firefox or from Firefox to Chrome or any of the browsers as well. So basically, what are browser add-ons? Browser add-ons are simple small piece of code that lets the users to enhance the functionality or modify the functionality of the browser. So suppose you guys must be using any of the browsers, like add-on browsers like Grammarly, Adblock Plus. You guys must be using them. So let's talk about few of them. So Grammarly helps you to find and fix the grammatical errors or punctuation error or mistake, whatever you want. So this is very friendly for us, because when we write a mail or anything content, we actually face issues related to articles, prepositions, and it can actually help you very easily. So next is Ghostry. This add-on is a privacy add-on which actually helps you to know who are the trackers that are tracking you on the specific website, and also whom you can block them as well. Like, you don't need to block everyone sometimes, but you can actually see who are the trackers and how can you block them as well. So this is a very good add-on since it is a privacy month. So I'll be focusing more about privacy add-ons as well. Next is PrivateX. This is also a privacy add-on, which actually, suppose we all know that we should view few of the sites in the private window or incognito window depending on the browser. So in that case, suppose you are using any traveling site, you should actually open it in the incognito window. Why? Because they actually increase the flight rates or something depending on the cookies, or they track you, right? So for that purpose, it alerts the user that you should view the specific website in the private window, and it actually opens the same URL. Instead of copying the URL and again writing that, you can just directly click that icon and it will open it. And also it blocks the UTM tokens as well. UTM tokens are the Google Analytics tokens that actually tracks you. So next is Facebook container. So Facebook container, it's, as the name says, it's actually creates a separate session or for your Facebook or Facebook identity as well. So whenever we are viewing any of the sites like Amazon, it displays the same ads on the Facebook, right? So it's very buggy or annoying to the users. So in that case, this helps. So it actually creates a separate session, and in that case, it makes it harder for Facebook to track you. So this is also a privacy extension, which you should install it and use it. If you find it cool, then keep it. The next is Tabigat. This is a very cool and simple, cute add-on, which just whenever you open a new tab, then it will show a different kinds of cat, showing different expressions and all. So this actually implies that the add-on can be from very simple to complex. This is very simple add-on, right? And Grammarly is like having an AI model in itself. So the variation of the add-on itself different. It depends on the user perspective and the preferences. So this is web extensions. How can you build an add-on? So cross browsers, this you can build your own add-on using web extensions, which is actually a cross browser system. So it simply means that whenever you are viewing you are creating an add-on for Chrome, you can simply port it in the Firefox. The same small piece of code can be used on the Firefox or Opera or Edge. And why should you use web extensions? Because all you need is basic JavaScript. I'm not asking you to use React.js, Node.js, or any kind of JS. Just basic JavaScript skills are enough to create your own add-on. And also, since all the documentations are on different platforms for Chrome as well, everything is similar. So you can use any of the documentations that you find it very friendly actually. And this is also compatible with the multi-process Firefox. So multi-process Firefox is actually the thing that whenever you open a tab, then it is itself a process. It's not the whole window is a process. So every tab is a process, and in that way, if one tab crashes, the whole window won't be getting affected with that. So this is compatible, and you can easily port your extension from one browser to another browser. This is how the architecture of web extensions looks like. So the basic heart of the web extensions lies in the manifest.json, which has background page, content scripts, browser action, option page, and web accessible resources. So I'll get into more detail of these things. So this is the structure of the manifest.json that looks like, and it actually has all the things related to your add-on, like version, name, description, permissions, browser action, and this is the actually all the configurations or all the files, you can say this is like where your add-on starts. So next is background scripts. So background scripts are actually the normal scripts that actually runs from the time of your installation of your add-on to the uninstallation times. And all these scripts can access the web extensions API very easily. And this is how you mention the background script in the manifest.json, the code that is mentioned. Next is content scripts. Content scripts are normal scripts which is actually specific to the few pages. Like suppose in the example, if you want the specific script to run on the mozilla.org extension domain, then you can embed this content script in that actually your code, and it will run only on this specific site URL whatever you are providing actually. And since content script cannot access the web extensions API, all the web extensions API, so it actually exchanges the messages with the background scripts in order to access the web extensions API. So this is quite similar to a normal web extension, normal scripts. Next is browser action. So browser action is the, like suppose whenever you want to add your add-on icon on the toolbar or on the address bar, there are two ways to add your add-on icon. It can be on the address bar or the toolbar. So suppose whenever you want to add on the toolbar, then browser action comes in the picture, and it should be there only when your add-ons feature are applicable to all the sites. Suppose Grammarly is applicable to all the sites, right? So it should be on the toolbar, and hence we use browser action. Otherwise we use page action. Page action as in, suppose private access there, it's limited to only banking sites or traveling sites. So this is why it is there on the address bar. So this is how we write the code in the manifest.json. Next is option page. Option page actually helps you to define the preferences so that the users can make changes to it. So this is how whenever a user installs this add-on, it gives the access privilege to the user so that they can change the preferences according to their, because every user has their own preferences. It can be like one user's like notification for the specific add-on, and one user might not like the notifications for that specific add-on. So this is, and how web extensions come into the picture, this is because of web extensions API. So I'll talk about few of them, not all, because there are lots of APIs. So these are the few APIs like notifications API, bookmarks, alarm API, tabs, storage API, web request API. Notifications API, other APIs as the name says, it notifies or alerts the user. Suppose I said that private access actually notifies or alerts the user, right? So it actually notifies them this way. So in that case, it is using notifications API. And this is very simple to use because you just need to use this code and you provide the icon title in the message, and this is how notification comes from the picture. This small piece of code helps you to give the notification. Next is alarm API. Alarm API, suppose you are trying to create an add-on which reminds the user to drink water on a periodic basis. Suppose after every 15 minutes, it should remind me. So in that case, I am creating this periodic alarm which actually repeats itself after every 2 minutes or 15 minutes, you can define any value, and it will trigger any API, or it will trigger that actually, alarm API. So here alarm API comes into the picture. Next is tabs API. If you will see, then browser.tabs.create actually helps in just creating the tab with a specific URL which you have mentioned. So this will create a tab with the URL example.org. this is it. All you need to know about is how to use the WebExtensions API. That's it. And it will just create the tabs. Whenever you want to deal with the tab IDs, tab creation, tab deletion, then we use the tab APIs. Next is Windows API. Windows API is almost similar to tabs. Instead of tab, we use Windows. And whenever you want to create a tab, create a window with different tabs, we provide a set of array of URLs, and it will create these URLs with these tabs in a window itself. So let's talk more about security, how secure an add-on is, whichever are there on the Chrome Web Store or add-ons mozilla.org. So whenever you install an add-on, it actually seeks permissions. It shows that whatever the add-on is actually accessing or developer is accessing from by installing your add-on. So if it says that accessing to all the data all the websites, so you should ensure that is that permission similar to what add-on speaks to do. So whenever you install an add-on, you should first see the ratings, reviews of that specific add-on, and also how is that coming from a specific brand, because generally it can be from it's always from the third party, and it can be anyone. It can be you, it can be me, and I can be attacker as well. I can say that my add-on does these things, but instead of this, I'm tracking every data, digital footprints of yours, and you might not know this, and you are actually at the risk of your security. So you should always view this, and also you should make sure that when you are installing, you should see the ratings and review of the add-ons. So next is, how can you port your add-on from one browser to another? Suppose you have written a small piece of code from Chrome for Chrome browser, then you can easily port it to the Firefox, because Firefox uses both the namespace, Chrome namespace and browser namespace. But when you are porting it from Firefox to Chrome, then all you need to change, like control F browser, then replace it with the Chrome keyword. That's it. And this is how you can just simply port your add-on to another browser. That's it. This is all required with no, it might be the case that you don't require any changes or very few changes. Next is, how can you debug your add-on? This is simply like, just go to the about : debugging page tab, and then you just load your template, load that manifest.json and enable the add-on debugging, and just select manifest.json, and then hence you can debug it, like as you debug any JavaScript code, like console.org and console.log. These are the tools which are used to create an add-on. Like for the beginners level, all you need is a text editor, be it Atom or Sublime Text. It's for the beginners, actually, webextensions.tech, which helps you to itself create everything, and it will help you to download a zip file and the format of the structure of every manifest.json, and hence you get started with the coding directly, so that you are not stuck with the starting process of the web extensions. For the hardcore developers who love to use command line tools, so this is web extension command line tool, which you just can use web extension run or lint or and all. Suppose whatever I showed in the debugging your extension, you can just use a run, and it will do the similar stuffs in the command line tool itself. This is how you can publish the add-on. I cannot show you, but I'll just post the slides after the session. All you need to do is go this page and register yourself and just publish it. For Chrome, you just need to pay 5 USDs for the first add-on, and for Firefox, it's free from the starting itself. These are the few resources which you can see after post this session. If you need any kind of help, you can just contact these IRC channels, mailing list, and if you are stuck with something, you can just drop a mail to this mailing list, and you can just get, like from the developers itself, you can just get in touch with them, and you can just ask your queries itself, and you can join the Telegram channel for the on-spot replies. That's all for the day from my end. Any questions?